Good afternoon. Thank you for coming and joining us on this cold, blustery day. I think we have the best place to be. This is terrific. I'm Linda Audie Brand. I'm the Director of Education and Community Engagement at the Lyric, and we are so excited about Silent Night. This has been a really big deal for us. We're right in the middle of all the tech process right now. On Thursday, there's the final dress. We have about 800 students coming to see that, which we're so pleased about. Friday, if you guys can join us again at 6:30, there's going to be this wonderful artists panel right there at the Kauffman Center in the Kauffman Theater. You'll be able to get a sneak peek of the set, and the composer and librettist will both be there, and they can give you all sorts of insights into how their process went. There'll also be Stanley Weintraub, who wrote the book Silent Night, so you can get a whole nonfiction, take on this entire process as well. It is my big, big pleasure to be able to introduce my friend Rebecca Johnson. She's a past president of the Guild, and she is just the most wonderful human being, as you guys know, because I bet you have all been to events hosted by her as well. She's a fantastic educator, and she is going to give you an abbreviated preview for the Silent Night, and then we'll be on to the movie. She'll also be giving the full preview before each of the operas, so you can just come to this particular event and learn all sorts of things. And aren't we lucky to be in the city with the National World War I Museum? This just couldn't have worked out better. So, without any further ado, Dr. Rebecca Johnson.
Well, that's a great introduction. We'll see how it goes here. You know, I don't know how many of you have been to the last two At Ease with Operas, but if you have, you may be sort of swinging around in your mind like I have been about these two speakers. The speakers last week, Scott Baker and Gail Levy from UMKC, they talked about the culture of Paris and Berlin just prior to the start of the war. And if you remember what they said, they talked about the folks were, there was residual resentment left over from the Franco-Prussian War. They felt that this was a war that would sort of reset the European continent, would sort of get it reorganized again. They were pretty much, in both cities and England, pretty much under the assumption that they were going to be home by Christmas. They would go fix the world and be home by Christmas. And there was sort of a joyous spirit. Let's just get on with it. And they did. On July 28, 1914, they got on with it and started the war. And then, if you can remember back to the first speaker, Dr. Lieutenant Colonel Sean Faulkner, he talked about the 5 years later. He talked about the 19 million deaths and the 20 million wounded. He talked about the weapons of mass destruction being used for the first time. As quick as one form of gas could get out there, a gas mask was developed to foil that. And so a new gas and a new gas mask. He talked about revenge killing in numbers that had never been seen. He talked about genocide. He talked about ethnic cleansing. And if you remember, he stood right over there, because I was sitting right there where I've been sitting, and he sort of gave this incredibly tragic 5 years down the road story, and he turned and he stopped and he said, you know, I've pretty much come to the conclusion that humanity sucks. And I don't know about you, but I just kind of took in this breath that went, oh, can he even say that on stage? And is that true? And I've just swung wildly between the two of those, these two speakers that gave, here's what started and here's what happened. And then that makes me think of this opera silent night, this moment, 1914, 5 months after the war started. Remember, they're supposed to be home by Christmas, and it's Christmas Eve, and they're not home. And the realization that this isn't going to go quite the way they were all expecting. And I think of this moment of still sort of innocent, though. It's obviously, we're not going to be home tomorrow. We're not going to make it by Christmas. It's pretty nasty out here. These trenches are cold and muddy and tiny, and we're all squished in, and I can't even put my head out of the trench without it getting blown off. Disease is rampant in these trenches. But, and the trenches are so close to your enemy, the Germans, the French, the British, that you can hear them talk. You can hear what's going on in these trenches of your enemies. And you're only a couple miles from your childhood home. It's all close still. The horrors are setting in, but they're not there yet. The barbed wire hasn't been put in no man's land. Weapons of mass destruction haven't quite hit the scene yet. And it's like this moment, this magical moment that's become legendary and yet actually happened, that they could have taken a pause. They could have stepped back and said, really? Do we want to do this? Kind of that's where this opera and that's where this movie starts. There had been other truces for sure. This wasn't the first truce, but this truce was possibly the last truce as the higher-ups and generals realized, as I believe the librettist of the opera, Mark Campbell, says, war is not sustainable when you come to know your enemy as a person. When you see that the person you might be shooting has a child or a wife, or has this life at home, and they're just not the enemy, then it becomes very difficult, if not impossible, to sustain war. 20 to 100,000 are the estimates of the number of people who participated in the Christmas Eve truce. And the legends that you have seen, or the stories you might have seen, them playing soccer, exchanging gifts, all true. The story that became this movie, that became the opera, was taken from letters from those who actually participated in this Christmas Eve truce. So, to have that sort of in your consciousness, the opera gets its impetus through Dale Johnson, who is the man you see in the center. He is the CEO and director of the Minnesota Opera, and he was watching the movie Silent Night. And as you watch it, I bet you can put your head in his head, because I watched the movie for the first time about 2 weeks ago, and as I watched it, I went, oh my gosh, if you put music into this, it's just going to make us puddle into a mass of weepy people. The story is tragic and poignant and tender and historical, but you put music into it and it's just going to reach into your emotional sense in ways that just the words and just the cinema wouldn't do. It'll be a different feel when you see the opera. So Dale Johnson watches the movie and says, this is great. I want this to be an opera. He had heard the music of Kevin Putz, who is on the to your left. He had heard his music and thought it was just right for this opera. Very lush, very orchestral, and I'm going to play a few clips for you here in just a few minutes. And that it would really set the tone beautifully for this opera. So he gets with Kevin Putz, and Kevin says, yes, I'll do it. But he had never written an opera before, so he needed someone skilled by his side to help bring this movie to operatic life. And so they contacted Mark Campbell, who had done other projects with the Minnesota Opera, and Kevin and Mark together developed the libretto that would work for the opera and the music. When you hear the music, and give me just a couple minutes and I'll play it for you, there is a... You know, if you're like me, when you hear that somebody composed something in the 20th century, my brain kind of swings from, well, is it going to have that sort of chaotic sound like Nixon in China, which is fabulous for that particular opera, but it's not tuneful and it's not tonal, and it sort of engages your brain to get through it. Is it going to be all melody, like something Verdi might have written? How's that going to feel? In this case, if you listen to the music like it's just this giant tapestry or fabric of lush sounds, sometimes great melodies, but it doesn't seem that that is Kevin's sort of focus. It's more on letting the music capture the fabric and the spirit of that event. And that's how I saw it. That's how I read it. So we'll see how you do after the opera itself. I've not seen the opera either. I've just seen portions of it. So I am assuming how it's going to be right along with you. These three men are responsible for this opera. Silent Night, the movie you're going to see, premiered in 2005. The opera premieres in 2012, just so you can get a bit of a... So let's talk about the plot. And I kind of went back and forth to say the plot or the story. We'll call it the plot today. And I'm not going to tell you too much about it. You're going to see it unfold. But I am going to tell you how I'm going to try to watch the opera itself. In the movie, you will be up close and personal with the characters, and you'll see the angst on these three lieutenants' face. This is Lieutenant Gordon of the Scottish side, Lieutenant Horstmeier of the German side, and Lieutenant Audebert of the French side. And while these may or may not be the main characters, you can decide for yourself, these three so well represent the layers of philosophical and moral decision-making that had to be done in that moment. As these three determine, will the men come out? Do we trust our enemy enough to say, let's give it a rest for a couple of days? When they have the second truce, they have a first truce on Christmas Eve night. They have a second truce on Christmas Day in order to bury all of the dead who were killed in the battle that happens just as the movie and the opera opens. Can you trust your enemies again? Have they gotten together and come up with a plot to kill you? You see the agony on these three men's face, and you also feel the agony there were in, and these are from real letters, this is truthful. As these enemy soldiers get together in no man's land on Christmas Eve, there was joking from the German to the French that said, well, when all of this is over, we'll just meet up in Paris and have coffee together, or we'll just come to your apartment. And so they do form these relationships, fraternizing with the enemy, which of course is treasonous. And so you see this, or at least I saw this most thoroughly in these three men and how they dealt with the situation that was given them. There's other characters besides these three lieutenants. There are not necessarily ancillary characters, but characters that sort of portray again the moral dilemma of all of the entire story. From the German side, there's two opera singers, Nicholas Sprink and Anna Sorensen, and they are lovers, and the entire show opens, or after a brief prologue, opens with the two of them singing on stage in the Berlin Opera House, singing an Italian opera in the style of Mozart or Gluck or someone like that. This opera has five languages in it, which is tricky if you know anything about how you set languages and stresses to the music. It's tricky to get that just right, musically speaking. But you have, when the French are speaking, it's in French. When the Germans speak, it's in German, or sing, I should say. When the British or the Scottish sing, it's in Scotch, or in English. And then there is the Italian singing of the opera. And then there is the, in the middle of the Christmas Eve truce, there is a mass that's going to be conducted in Latin. So you have five languages that the librettist and the musician and the composer had to work through. So we have the German side with Lieutenant Horstmeier, and then Anna Sorensen and Nicholas Sprink, the opera singer. On the Scottish side, the main characters are two brothers, After Lieutenant Gordon, it is William and Jonathan Dale, young brothers who, when they come into the war, they're like, bring it on, I'm ready. William, the older brother, is going to die before this even, just as it opens, he's going to fall dead. And Jonathan, the younger brother, is going to have to agonize that his older brother has died in no man's land, alone, and he can't even go out there and bury him at that moment. So you'll feel the agony of this younger brother, and watch the younger brother as the story progresses, because you'll also feel his anger and his bitterness, and you'll see how that plays out. And suddenly, at least for me, towards the end of the movie, I went, yeah, I can see why this all continued on to such a horde for another 4 to 5 years. So you have these two brothers. These two brothers also come over with their parish Anglican priest, Father Palmer. And Father Palmer, you won't see much of him to start, but he has this incredibly important role midstream through, which I'll talk about in just a minute. And then from the French side, the only other character to really kind of pay attention to besides Lieutenant Audebert is his aide Ponchel. And I've read that Ponchel is a bit of a comic relief, but he's comic relief in the way that he's this really good soul. He sort of represents the everyman peasant, and you will love him. You will love him. So the opera opens. Something that I have read is just so true to this war is you either shoot people or hide, but you don't get to sleep. There is just no sleeping. And so one of the most beautiful moments, at least that I have found, is after that first battle, when the first battle rages and then they are sort of all back in their trenches, the sleep chorus is one that the men sing. And this is just a baby step, or at least to let you see what the opera is going to look like and what the opera is going to sound like. If I understand from what Linda Audibrand has said, it's the same set, the same, what you're about to see is how the opera will be. So if you could play that clip. It was about that point in the movie that I started to sob, and I'm pretty sure it's about that point in the opera that I'm going to be sobbing also. So if you hear a lot of sniffles, that'll be me. One thing I wanted to tell you, as you could see there, the stage for this opera is in the round, and it's much like if you've seen Les Miserables. It rotates around, and so you have the French on one third, the Scots on one third, and the English on one third, and in the middle is no man's land. And what I just found out is that also this stage will open up, as you just saw, to allow for just more of the drama. For the party, just opens up. So I cannot wait to see it. So as the opera takes place, as you'll see in the plot, there is another moment where there is one woman who is just about the only female role, Anna Sorensen. And she's the girlfriend of Nicholas Sprink on the German side, and she accompanies him to no man's land on Christmas Eve. He wants to, performing for the Crown Prince of Germany, and then she wanted to stay there that night, but he said, no, I have to go back to my men. I have to sing to the men, and so that's what starts it. He goes back with her. He sings Silent Night. They hear it on all sides, the French and the English. Bagpipes accompany what they hear the Germans singing. The Germans were given these gifts just the day of Christmas Eve, of little Christmas trees with candles. This is true, by the way. These things are all true. This is how it happened. And they hold these trees up, and then Nicholas Sprink, these characters are not real, but Nicholas is based on a real character, an opera singer. He begins to sing Silent Night, and Scots will come back and join him with their bagpipes. Eventually the British sing. They'll exchange the gifts that they were given that day. The French were given chocolate and wine, and you can imagine what the Scots were given, Scotch whiskey. And so when they finally, the tree comes out from the Germans, they all tentatively come out of their trenches, and they exchange all of these gifts. Something to remember, all of these nations share the same faith. They're Christian nations, Anglican or Catholic. And we have Father Palmer, and this is where he becomes so important. He gives a Christmas Eve mass that night for all of the men. And Anna Sorensen, who is the only woman there, sings this beautiful, during the mass, Dona Nobis Pacem solo. And she sort of represents the longing for wife, sister, mother, daughter, all women. And so I've got that clip just briefly queued up for you. This should be the one before this, I think. Okay, let's go to the one after it. I've skipped ahead of myself. It's okay, there. Collective breath together. She'll sing that, the Christmas Eve truce will close, through the events you'll see articulated in the movie, the next day, Christmas Day, they decide to call a truce again to allow everyone to bury the dead, including, if you remember, the young, not William, the young Jonathan's, his older brother. And so they bury, they have the mass burial of all who have died. And then they have the mass burial. I'm not gonna play the next piece. I'm not gonna do, so we can just skip ahead to the last slide. When you watch the opera, however, when you see the men deciding, should we do a second truce, should we, they'll sing a song, this war or this where shall not be settled. And that's their argument to go ahead and do another piece. It's not gonna be settled today, so let's bury the dead. And the music, you've heard, I've played two very pretty pieces for you, but the music at that moment will have a little bit of a more chaotic underpinnings, and you'll hear the chaos that I think Kevin Petz has done so well, has portrayed the tragedy of all of this, the chaos of all of this, and yet sort of this human spirit that just keeps moving forward. These are good people. You will root for everybody just about in this opera, in this movie. The movie, I want to point out just two things that are different between the movie and the opera. The movie is going to open with children singing songs of hate. If it's a French child, they will sing a song of hate towards the Germans. The Germans will sing a song of hate towards the French. And you'll see these three children. And it's shocking because they say, we want all the Germans dead. And these are little eight-year-olds, innocent. And I thought maybe that was just put into the movie for, you know, dramatic license. I was watching a documentary recently. These songs existed. These children sang these songs of the world would be better if all of the Germans were dead. And so Kevin Putz and Mark Campbell felt that they couldn't put these children's songs in the opera without it seeming, and this is just an actual word, a bit hokey. And so you don't see the children in the opera, but I want you to know that these things actually did happen. The other thing you don't see in the opera, and I don't know why it's not in there, but in the movie, Father Palmer is going to be relieved of his position because he will be seen as a traitor to the church. And there'll be a speech by the priest who removes Father Palmer. And the speech will be, there is no good German unless it's a dead German. And it is a vitriolic, all good Scotsmen and all good English must kill the Germans. And it's one of those intakes of breath where you go, I just can't believe I'm hearing this hate. Again, when I saw it, I thought it was in there for effect. It is actually taken, as you listen to it, it's taken word for word from a speech given to new recruits in Westminster Abbey in 1915. So it's slightly out of context with the actual events, but it's an actual speech that happened. The other things you'll see are true and verified through letters, how this happened, and the movie and the opera dovetail very close together. So I will let you watch the plot on your own, and I'll look forward to seeing you at the opera, which opens this Saturday, I believe.